All right, guys. This is Ty Zen. I got my buddy LeonFu.com on here. And it's been a while since we've had an opportunity to get together for our broadcast, guys, because, you know, we've tried to research Steemit and several other new ICOs coming out and new cryptocurrencies coming out to invest in. But so for some freaking reason, this DAO hub attack stuff, this fiasco just won't go away, and it just keeps eating up and sucking up all our time instead of doing research on stuff that's actually going to help us make more money in crypto. Okay, and in this one, in this episode, guys, we want to talk about the DAO attacker. A lot of focus has been put on the DAO hub, the Slockit team, the Ethereum Foundation, and everything, but no one's actually talked about the DAO attacker. So this episode is for, you know, our viewers, and just to help get a better understanding of the psychology and the mindset and the motivation and the purpose behind the DAO attacker. We're confident that he's going to be listening on this. So we're talking to you too, Mr. DAO attacker. Okay. So here are some clues that we have gathered from my background involvement with the government and law enforcement, and LeonFu.com's background in software development and coding, and the skill level it takes to pull off the DAO attack. Okay, so you want to start off with about the being the insider?
Well, you know, there's not that many people who know Ethereum well enough to have done what was done to the DAO, right? It's just too new. There's really only a handful of people that had the ability to even do that, right?
So it's safe to say that it's somebody that Vitalik would personally know.
Yeah, this isn't just me saying it. This is even Tual who said that, you know, he doesn't think there's any more than 200 people in the whole world that could even have done that. Right?
Yeah, because the programming language that Ethereum is coded in is in Solidity, right?
Yes, and that's it's a brand new language. And
so there's not enough like you are one of the top coders in iOS app, right?
I haven't studied Ethereum. You would have to know Ethereum on a very deep level.
Like you actually have to work on it.
Yeah, you actually have to be working on it on a daily basis. It's something that you do on a daily basis, right?
So somebody that's a good coder like yourself, even in iOS and iPhone apps and stuff, you can't just run over and learn Solidity for a week or a month or 3 months and then attack the DAO and steal $60 million.
Yeah, no.
That's not realistic at all.
That's not realistic. So it's only my, you know, I don't think there's more than 100 people that even has the capability to do that. And out of those 100 people, I don't even think that no more than a few dozen would have even seen this bug. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Unless it was pointed out to them, right?
Yeah. So it's somebody that has to work on it on a regular basis.
Yeah, because the code was reviewed by a lot of like the Slockit guys and people that did work on this every day, right?
Yeah.
Members of the Ethereum Foundation and members of the Slockit guys, and they all missed it, right?
Yeah.
So it was really
and just to give the audience an idea, like for example, let's pull one guy out, Christoph Jansch.
Jansch, yeah.
Yeah, I mean he wrote the entire Ethereum wallet client in C++ or something like that.
Well, I don't remember which one.
It's one of the Jansch brothers.
Yeah,
right?
Of the Jansch brothers.
So he's not a dummy.
No one on the team is. No.
Yeah, so I mean they might have made mistakes, but let's just admit that I mean even smart people make mistakes too. But these guys are not dummies.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean when we're dealing with software, it doesn't matter how smart you are, you're going to make a mistake. I mean, that's why we have bugs, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, so you know we're pretty certain that it's somebody who's very close to the Ethereum project, the Ethereum Foundation.
Yeah.
And so the you know, we've already said in our previous interviews, we don't think it's has to do with money, because somebody that close to the project already has a lot of money, right? I mean,
yeah, but before we jump to the motivation to do it, which is, you know, some people speculate that it's the money. Let's just finish. Let me share this story with you about the law enforcement that I encounter. Okay, so I have a friend. He's in federal prison right now, and he's doing either 24 or 30 years in federal prison for the biggest armor truck robbery in Phoenix, Arizona, in the state of Arizona. I think it was in the city of Phoenix, but I know for sure it's in Arizona, right? It's the biggest armor truck robbery. And you know how they got to inside the armor truck? Because I don't know if you're familiar with this, but they have like two people on this particular armor truck that he was the driver. And so there's usually two people, and usually the way that it's set up, the two people are separated so that you can't like intimidate one person, like put a gun to one person's head and get the other person to open the door to the armored truck.
Okay.
You follow me? Like,
yeah,
like
sure.
There's security issues to prevent, like in case the armored truck is on its route, it gets hijacked or something, that even if you put a gun to one individual's one guard's head, the other guard, it requires like two people or something like that to open up the safe, the lock inside the armored truck in order to get access to the money and stuff. Okay. So what happened was there was a deal where the lock was messed up inside the armored truck. And my friend had made several attempts to let the armored truck company know that the lock is messed up, and that if somebody was to get inside the driver's compartment, that they can unlock pretty much the armored truck and get inside to all the money. Right. So in other words, they only have to subdue one person in order to get to the money instead of having to subdue two people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know how, like, whenever they go into the armored truck, one person's inside the vehicle, the other person's standing outside in guard and stuff, you know? So you have to, the way that the armored trucks are set up, the security for it, you need to like take control of both guards of that armored truck in order to get to the money. But in his case, the armored truck was messed up. Right there, the lock was messed up.
Yeah.
The locking, I don't know how it works, but he said that the locking mechanism was messed up. So it only required that you subdue one person and you can get access to the money.
Okay.
So what happened was when they got arrested, right? The gang that hijacked that armored truck, right? I don't know how it was, but they were able to hit this armored truck that had a weak security, a faulty security, and they were able to get the money.
Yeah.
And so the FBI, when they investigated it, they found the first thing that they look at is who is the insider. So they investigate the driver, the passenger of that armored truck, investigate their family and everything, because it's like over 90% of the time it's an inside job. Same thing with bank robberies. It's an inside job, right?
Yeah.
So anything that happens like that, it's usually an inside job. And they refused to accept the fact that the lock was faulty, that it was broken.
All right.
And so they blamed it on my friend, the driver. And they said that he was the one who set up the whole heist, the armored truck heist and everything.
Oh, so he was set up.
Yeah, so what happened was they couldn't figure out who the inside man was, and it was just random luck that they got the armored truck that had a faulty lock on it, so they didn't have to subdue both people.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So in order to make the case, they caught the armed robbers. Okay? They caught the armed robbers, and they got the armed robbers to cooperate with the federal government to snitch out my friend and accuse him of being the ringleader.
Okay.
Can you believe that? So they were the ones who robbed the truck, and they turned around and accused my friend, the driver, of being the ringleader. And if you, I mean, if you know this guy, he's just incapable of doing something like this.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, that's
sure,
just not
yeah.
his nature, you know. And so what happened is now he's sitting in prison for like, I don't know, 24, 30 years.
Wow. All
right.
Right? Yeah.
And guess what? The other guys are all free on the streets now.
The guys that actually did the robbery.
Yeah, the guys that actually did the robbery, right, uh-huh. got away with it and pinned it on my friend.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the reason why I share this story with you is because that faulty, the reason why they suspect that, you know, and they point all the evidence of all, they use all previous older cases where they said that, hey, look at all these old armored truck cases that got robbed. It's always the inside guys, either the passenger or the driver that provided the information to them, right? So what happened was, even though in this case that was not the case, they still pinned it on him because the guys that actually did the robbers actually cooperated with the government and accused him of being the one
sure,
that was
sure.
the inside man. So because of that, it all, you know, they had all the evidence that they needed to convict
yeah.
my friend, even though he was not, you know, part of it. Okay. So in this particular case, with the Dow attack, it's definitely someone on the inside. Because only somebody that's close to Vitalik and close to the project that's working on, like you said, would have known that there was a bug. There was a faulty lock mechanism.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So now, that's I'm just sharing that because most of the time when things like this happen, it's an insider. Now,
yeah. Go ahead.
So let's jump to the talk where you talk about the motivation, where everybody
yeah.
thinks that you know the guy is doing this, the Dow attacker is doing it for money, and we both agree that. There's no way he's doing this for money because if he's an insider, he's already gotten a part of the initial part of the Ethereum. He would have been in at the early stages.
Yeah.
So he would have made, I mean, like you and I, you know, I mean, we're not even an insider and we came out with, you know, 4,000 or 5,000% profits.
Sure.
So why wouldn't the guy that's part of the insider crew have an even bigger advantage?
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Plus, he's probably getting paid in the original ICO ethers.
In the ethers, yeah. He's probably getting paid in ethers because they did help hold back
a portion for all the developers.
Yeah, for the developers, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the motivation that a lot of people say that's for money, I refuse to believe it's for money because here's the reason why. I'm going to give you some numbers, okay, because people are going to hear me say that and they're going to think we're nuts, okay? A lot of people say that the dumbasses out there that don't trade, they're saying that the Dow attacker did it because he shorted ethers on the exchange in order, and then he crashed it so that he can make a ton of money on shorting the ethers. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know. I don't know if you've shorted ethers, but I have shorted ethers multiple times just to do some testing, you know, so that whenever uh-huh. we broadcast it, you know, we can talk about it with authenticity. And I can tell you this, as soon as I shorted it, I realized I made a huge mistake. Right. And I try to get out of that position as soon as I can. And,
yeah.
and you know what the mistake is? It's not like shorting the euro or the pound or the yen in the currency market, in the Forex market, because
mm-hmm.
when you short those, right, you're using 50-to-1 leverage. You're using 50-to-1 leverage, and in European countries, you're using 100-to-1 leverage. So
sure.
the leverage in that allows you to get a huge percent profit if the move is correct. In other words, you're betting that the currency is going to go downhill, and because the 50-to-1 leverage, which means that if you put up a dollar, the broker will let you trade with $50.
Sure.
Right? You put up $1 of your own money, and the Forex broker will let you control up to $50 of currency in the U.S. and up to $100 in Europe. So when you do that, it makes sense to short it, and the liquidity is so big in the currency, in the Forex market, that whenever you click buy or sell, it's instant fill. There's like no problems or no issues with the fill, okay?
Sure.
But when you try to short Ethereum, man, it is forever to get filled.
Yeah, yeah, there's no
right?
liquidity, yeah.
And on top of that, they only give you 2.5-to-1 margin,
yeah.
okay? So here's the problem, okay? In case you're new to cryptocurrency shorting, here's the problem with shorting even a high liquidity, a high volume a crypto such as Ethereum. Let's just say that you were 100% right on the short. Let's say you were 100% right on the short and it goes all the way down to zero. And you cash out like one Satoshi before it hits zero, right? and you made the whole move on the way down. You made 100% of the drop. And guess what the best case scenario is for your profit is? Guess what the best profit that
Well, you said 2.5 to 1 leverage, right?
So yeah.
Two and a half times, right?
Yeah, but you make 100% profit is what I'm saying.
Oh, all
right. Right? So if, let's say you short, the best case scenario is that you make 100% profit or you make the 2.5 times to 1, which
sure.
is 250% profit.
Sure.
Right? So that's the absolute best case scenario that you can get, right? Now, if you're an insider and you've held on to Ethereum, it's gone up like 5-6. At one point, it was up over 70x, which is 7,000% profit.
Yeah.
Why the hell would you risk? How are you going to say that you're going to make a lot of money by shorting it and making 100 to 250% profit?
Yeah, that's
when the upside potential, if you ask anybody that has any clue or any sense about Ethereum, if you ask him, hey, do you think that Ethereum will fall and lose everything first, or is the likelihood that Ethereum will go to zero, or the likelihood that it will go 200, 300, 400, 500% profit?
Yeah. So,
right?
So the hacker, if he is an insider, he has much more to gain by Ethereum going to 100 than
going
to 5. Yeah,
exactly. So it doesn't make sense. If you just do the math, and if you guys are not sure, just take a few satoshis and go short it on Ethereum, on Poloniex, and you'll see what I'm talking about. It takes forever for it to make 50% or 25 or 50% profit. Whereas if you go long on it, right away you can get like 50% profit like almost immediately. You know, if there's a pump or if there's a spike up in price, you can be up 25, 50% in like no time. Whereas when you short it, it takes forever.
So let's talk about like the motivation. We understand the math that if we are correct and this guy was an insider, then if it's about money, there's more money to be made by the project succeeding
than it is for it to crash,
than it is for it to fail. So why do we think that he did this?
Okay, so here's a couple of things that I'm going to throw out there, okay?
Mm-hmm.
One is that the motivation is not a financial motivation. It's about egos.
There have been reports of them accusing the team members of being egomaniacs.
So the term egomaniacs is thrown around a lot with the Ethereum team. You don't see that with any of the other cryptocurrency teams.
Yeah.
If you notice that, you don't see the term the use of the word egomaniacs with any other crypto team except for the Slocket team and the Ethereum.
Yeah, the Ethereum guys.
Ethereum guys. You don't see that in any other community, okay?
Yeah.
So it's ego, and it's somebody, if you had to profile this individual, that this DAO attacker, he is someone that is an introvert. Okay?
Okay.
Or he's one of those people that is an introvert, a passive aggressive, somebody that instead of bringing it up to the forefront, right, they'll attack you behind your back.
Yeah.
Right? So they're like a silent person, and they probably suggested something in the development phase of Ethereum, and the other team members did not recognize their contribution, right? And then instead, on top of it, they probably threw salt on the wound. Instead of recognizing him for his contribution, they probably turned around and used it later on in the development phase and took credit for it.
I could see there's some bad blood between.
Yeah. So there's some type of bad blood where it would force them to say that, you know what? You know, it's like, screw you, you know, and I'm going to show you, you know, that you ain't about shit.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. To really knock them down.
Yeah. To knock them down. And meanwhile, they're silently basking in the failure of Ethereum. And this DAO attacker does not need to be what do you call that? On one side, you know, he is somebody that wants to be recognized for his contribution to the Ethereum, but he's also one of those people that that also relishes and cherishes the fact that the other guys are failing at this, right? So there's an ego issue where, you know what, the Tao attacker is secretly attacking them, and the entire Ethereum Foundation, the Ethereum team, Vitalik, the Slocket team, everybody's working to counter it, and they're unable to do it without a hard fork.
But here's the thing. Okay, so we know about, like, we can think about, like, what the motivation of the Tao attacker was, but what do we think about who the heck is supporting Ethereum Classic now?
Okay, just one more thing about the Tao attacker before we jump to the support for Ethereum Classic, okay?
Yeah.
It's also a one individual, and it's a guy.
The Tao attacker?
The Tao attacker, if I had to profile him, right, is a male.
It's an individual. That many females that have the skills to even be able to do that, right?
It's one individual. It's not a team. Like some people say, it's a group. It's one individual.
Sure.
And if you ask me, how do you know that, Ty? Right? If you ask me, how do you know that? Because when I was dealing with the U.S. law enforcement and the U.S. government and the court systems and everything, I can tell you this: you cannot keep two people from shutting the fuck up.
Sure.
If two people know something, one of them is gonna snitch the other one out or say something to somebody else. So the fact that the Tao attack has gone this long, and we still don't know who it is, and we don't have a clue who it is, right? Other than the clues that we provided in this episode. I mean, the clues we provide in this episode is much more valid than most of the garbage that you read on, like, CryptoCoin, Bitcoin news and you know, cryptocurrency news and all that other crap that they just slap together without any, you know, real, like, thoughtful, logical thinking through it, you know, and just, you know, clickbait. But anyway, it's one individual. And I can tell you this, throughout the history of the U.S. court system, they have not been able, like, any crime where they cannot find the criminal, right? It's because it's one person. Whenever there's more than one person, it's always the other person is going to snitch them out.
Sure.
Right? Yeah. They snitch them out. They're going to mention it to somebody, right? I knew a guy one time, this drug dealer, he buried $2 million in cash under the sidewalk in front of his house.
Okay.
No, I'm not kidding you. Like, it's under the sidewalk in front of his house. When he built the house, he stashed $2 million under the sidewalk in front of his house. And never in his frickin' mind did he ever imagine that someone would ever find it. Because he was the one who built the house, and he was the one who dug the hole and put the $2 million in cash in there. And he was the one who put the concrete on top of it. So who else would possibly know about that? Right? Uh-huh. Well, guess what he did? He only told one other person that he trusted in case something was to happen. Right?
And that person told,
And that other person gave him up.
Yeah. Okay.
Right?
Okay.
And it was his own brother. You know what I'm saying?
All right. Yeah.